Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for our time here today. We ask that you would speak to us. Give us ears to hear and eyes to see. Help us to embrace your truth and to reject all lies, to be able to discern between the truth and the lie. For we know freedom, true freedom, is found in truth. As your word declares, we shall know the truth, and the truth will make us free. Help us to be a people of truth, even if it hurts. And we know truth hurts, even as correction does, for correction is bringing clarity to an area where clarity is needed, to correct one's behavior, to set one on the path of righteousness, on the path of truth. And you said that correction is not pleasant when it comes. Father, I pray that we'll be able to embrace, to receive, and then to communicate with the spirit of love, the truth that you reveal to us, to those who are willing to hear it. I thank you for our time here today. I pray that your spirit be loosed and that you stir up the spirit within us, creating us clean hearts and renew the right spirit. Cause us to embrace that which you give to us. Stir up the manifestations of your spirit. We pray today for healing, for deliverance, for wholeness in every area, in emotions. We pray for wholeness in physical bodies. We pray for healing. Father, we pray that you will deliver us from the things that hold us back, every habit, every addiction, everything that exalts itself against your knowledge, every excuse that we make. For we know the days are short and we've got a lot of work to do. Help us as you equip us through your word to be about your business, to focus on the things that you are calling us to know that calling. And we ask for eyes to see and ears to hear. We thank you for every person who have put their hands to the plow in this ministry and in your kingdom. And we pray that even now you be glorified as your kingdom come, as your will is done, in Messiah Yeshua. Amen.
Exodus chapter 3, verse 12. And Yahuwah said, I will be with you, and this will be the sign to you that it is I who have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you will worship me on this mountain. Revelation 12, verse 16. And the 24 elders who were seated on their thrones before Yahuwah fell on their faces and worshiped him, saying, We give you thanks, Yahuwah Elohim, the one who is and who was, because you have taken your great power and have begun to reign. I will worship you, Yahuwah Elohim. I will worship you, Yahuwah, my Elohim. Yahuwah, my Elohim, I will worship you. Yahuwah, I will give you praise. Yahuwah Elohim, I will give you praise, I will praise your name, Yahuwah Elohim, I will bow my knee yes, oh yes,
oh yes, yes, I will. I will worship you.
I will lift my voice.
I
will bless your name.
Yahuwah.
Yahuwah.
Elohim.
Elohim.
I will worship you.
Toda Father.
I will worship you.
Yahuwah.
Well, shalom, shalom. Shabbat shalom, everyone. Today, we're going to be talking about a topic that really, when I think about it, probably don't need to be taught on. But because of the times and the signs of the times that we're in, it must be taught on. And that is the Biblical New Year. And the reason why we're going to be talking on this particular subject is because not only is those who are in Messianic faith and even in Messianic Judaism, Hebrew roots, and in the Christian community as well as the world, there are things that are going on in the midst of us that we really need to understand the origin. We need to know where things are coming from. The more we know about where things come from, the better we are as it relates to how we respond to it. And I think it's important for us as believers, as with anything that we celebrate, to know what it is that we're celebrating, why we're celebrating, and determine whether or not we should be celebrating. As long as I've been in this walk, and in ministry, it seems every time I look at the Bible, even as I've prepared for this message today, that I see things that I haven't seen before or read over. You ever just read the Bible and sometimes you read something and it's like, you know, I never saw that before, or you've seen it before, read over it, and never really contemplated or thought about, meditated, just read over. As a Christian, we were taught to read the Bible, and there were certain versions or certain passages that we were taught to memorize. And in the memorization of Scripture, we were always, depending on the denomination that you were a part of, you memorized the pet passages of that particular denomination. And what you're going to find is most of the denominations, if not all of the denominations in Christendom, in religion period, and for us, because many of us came out of Christendom, some of us came out of Judaism, that every denomination has its favorite part of the Bible that it builds itself on. And so these are called doctrines. Yeshua warned us in the Bible that we ought to beware of the leaven. And the leaven he's referring to is not bread, although many look at the word as the bread of life, that which feeds and sustains us. The Bible says man should not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of Jehovah. So the word is considered spiritually as bread to our spirit. And yet, when it comes down to leaven, Yeshua says that we are to beware of the leaven, which translates teachings and doctrine. That the leaven that we are fed, the word that we are fed, it formulates a denominational position in our walk, in our spirit, in our lives. When those positions are encroached upon or, you know, you get too close to exposing where these things come from, some people can get fighting mad. Others will accuse of tampering with the Bible when it's in actuality, you're tampering with doctrine, pulling the rug out from under people, or causing people to be shipwrecked, or affecting, especially new believers, and this is a good one. You know, you want to avoid certain things because, you know, you got a lot of new people coming in and you don't want to cause them to be shipwrecked in their faith. Let me tell you something. The worst thing you could do to a new believer is allow false teaching to stand. Because like many of us, at some point in our life and in our walk, we come to realize, like just last night, I'm having this imaginary conversation in my head with my mother. And in this imaginary conversation that I'm having with my mother, basically my siblings are, they're not attacking me, but they are kind of attacking me because they perceive that I'm attacking what my mom allowed to stand and taught us over the years. For example, as we're dealing with this whole issue on Christmas, I was brought up in Christmas. How many of you were brought up and celebrated Christmas? And in the conversation, my mom is saying, you know, we taught you, we brought you up to believe in God. We brought you up in a Christian home. And I challenged my mother in this Christian home. It's like, Mom, you brought us up to believe things that are not true. You brought us up to go to church on Sunday. Where is that at in the Bible? You brought us up to celebrate Easter. Where is that in the Bible? We know that Easter is there, but it is actually the word that is used to displace Pesach or Passover. You brought us up to believe in Christmas. Where is that in the Bible? There are many things that we were taught in this Christian home that we've later come to realize are flat out lies. And how can people who teach the book of truth be teaching us lies? Can you see where this is going? And so I'm not attacking my mom, nor am I attacking the Bible. I'm attacking things that have been taught as truth that we've learned are lies. And the question is that once you have been taught a lie and that lie is confronted with truth, do you continue to believe a lie, or do you make the transition, embrace the truth, and abandon the lie? Because here's what the Bible teaching, this is the conversation. You shall know the truth, and the truth will make you free. A lie will keep you in bondage. Are you with me? Now, this stuff that I'm saying seems harsh, and it seems as if you're attacking people's faith. We're not attacking anybody's faith. We're attacking traditions that have been taught as truth that are now being exposed for the lies they are. Oh, you all can see we're going to have some fun here today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So our message today is the biblical New Year. America around the world celebrate the New Year in the winter at midnight on December 31st, January 1st. The Jewish community celebrate the New Year in the fall at sundown on Rosh Hashanah or Yom Teruah, which is actually the Feast of Trumpets, but the Jewish community call it the New Year, although Yom Teruah is the seventh month on the Jewish calendar. The question is when does the creator of the universe command us to observe the beginning of months or the first month of the year? the new year. And how did we get so far off from his calendar? And what I'm hoping today is to help people make adjustments, because you're going to see that when it comes down to the Creator's reckoning of time, that he doesn't operate by our calendar. He operates by his reckoning of time, which we could say is a biblical reckoning of time, though he did not necessarily give us a calendar that, you know, we go by. His calendar is in the heavens. And so that's where our focus should be. Exodus 12:1 makes it very clear when the new year begins. Exodus 12:1, and Jehovah spoke unto Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt. He spoke to Aaron, he spoke to Moses, and where were they? They were in the land of Egypt. Now, notice what he says. He says, this month shall be unto you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year to you. Now, those of you who know anything about Egypt and the Egyptian calendar, you'll note that the Egyptian calendar today is pretty much the same as it was in the day that Jehovah spoke this. But Egypt had a reckoning of time when Jehovah said to Moses and to Aaron, this month is going to be the beginning of the year for who? For you. Now he's speaking to Israel. And right here in Exodus chapter 12, he says, now Egypt's got its calendars and the nations around has their calendars, but here is going to be the calendar that you're going to follow. And what's unique about this is that not only does he give them a particular month to follow as the beginning of months, but something significant happens. This is going to be the month that he set them free from their captivity. And so by this setting free from the captivity, it actually begins a new life for the Israelites, and it starts at a particular month. By reading a little further, we conclude the first month of the year is the month of the Aviv. Some say Abib, also called Nisan. Now, it's important as we look at this, because I don't give a definition of Nisan, because Nisan really has no definition other than the first month. Aviv, on the other hand, Aviv has a definition. It means ear of corn. Now, the fact that he uses this particular month, Aviv is not the name of a month. It is the condition of a crop. And it's important to understand that the condition of the crop is what the children of Israel identified as the beginning of the month or the first month of the year. He says in verse 3, speak ye unto all the congregation of Israel. So he's speaking to Moses and Aaron in Egypt and saying, listen, you communicate this to all of Israel, the entire congregation, saying, in the 10th day of this month. Now he's already established the first month. He says, now in the 10th day of the first month, you shall take to them every man a lamb according to the house of their fathers, a lamb for a house. And if the household be too little for the lamb, let him and his neighbor next unto his house take it according to the number of the souls. Now, where is this at? Where are they? They're in Egypt. Now, it's important because the words that is surrounding this passage is done one time in Egypt. Every other Passover after this particular Passover is not done in Egypt, whereas there is no longer, after they leave Egypt, a need to put blood on the doorpost of their home because there is no more death angel. Not over the children of Israel. This is a one-time event. Now, some people want to take what happened in Egypt and bring it into the new land and then to America and then hold people to account as to what happened in Egypt when this was a one-time event. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a male of the first year. You shall take it out from the sheep or from the goats, and you shall keep it until the 14th day of the same month. So the Passover, Pesach, people say was the Passover lamb. The bottom line is Pesach. Okay? Jehovah says this Pesach could come from what? The sheep or from the goat. Now, most people eat sheep. Rarely do you find people having goat on Pesach, but again, this is his command. And you shall keep it up until the 14th day of the same month. And the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it in the evening, and they shall take of the blood and strike it on the two side posts and on the upper door posts of the houses wherein they shall eat it. And they shall eat the flesh in that night, roast with fire and unleavened bread and with bitter herbs they shall eat it. Eat not of it raw, nor sodden at all with water, but roast with fire, his head with his legs, and with the pertness thereof. And you shall let nothing of it remain until the morning, and that which remaineth of it until the morning you shall burn with fire, and thus you shall eat it, with your loins girded, with your shoes on your feet, and your staff in your hand. Now, I had some people bring me a staff and says, you know, when you eat Passover, you got to eat your Passover with the staff in your hands, with your feet girded, your loins girded, and your shoes on your feet, and you eat it in haste. Now, the fact that Passover takes some people 3 and 4 hours let you know that, you know, there's not a lot of hasty eating. But there are people. Because of this passage, this is what they do. For I will pass through the land of Egypt. You see. So now he's going to pass through the land of Egypt. He doesn't pass through the land of Israel on Passover. Once they entered the land to look for the firstborn. There are different instructions given to the children of Israel concerning the firstborn when they enter the land. There was no redemption of the firstborn here. Are you hearing me, ladies and gentlemen? For I will pass through the land of Egypt this night and will smite all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast, and against all the gods of Egypt. I will execute judgment. I am Jehovah. He says, listen, I'm going to kill some people and I'm going to judge some things. And the blood shall be to you for a token upon the houses where you are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you, and the plague shall not be upon you to destroy you when I smite the land of Egypt. And this day shall be unto you for a memorial, and you shall keep it a feast to the Lord throughout your generations. You shall keep it a feast by an ordinance forever. 7 days you shall eat unleavened bread. Even the first day you shall put away leaven out of your houses. For whosoever eateth leavened bread from the first day unto the seventh day, that soul shall be cut off from Israel. And in the first day there shall be a holy convocation, and in the seventh day there shall be a holy convocation to you. No manner of work shall be done in them, save that which every man must eat, that only may be done of you. And you shall observe the feast of unleavened bread, for in this self-same day have I brought your armies out of the land of Egypt. Therefore shall you observe this day in your generations by an ordinance forever. In the first month, on the 14th day of the month at even, you shall eat unleavened bread until the 1 and 20th day of the month at even. So what is he saying? He's saying here, here's your first month. And during the first month, Here's what you are to do on the 14th day, on the 15th day, on the 20th day. So he's giving specific instructions on what days are to be observed and what month it is to be observed, which is the first month of the year for Israel. The word Abib, the month of the Exodus, or deliverance from Egypt, Exodus 13:4, and thus of the Passover festival, a harvest month covering parts of March and April. Abib means ears of grain or ear of corn. Now, when we think of corn, what do we think of? We think of that ear with the shuck, but, you know, this is not what he's talking about. It's later the month was called Nisan, and throughout the Torah, the word Nisan is never mentioned. The reason why it's called Nisan in the book of Esther is because the children of Israel are now in captivity. The word Nisan is Babylon. It's a Babylonian name. When they went into Babylon, they began to cease using the name Aviv or Abib and adopted the name Babylon because they were in, or Nisan, because they were in where? Babylon. Nisan means nothing. Now, once you adopt a calendar with Nisan 14, then all you have now is the date of a particular month, not Aviv. You're no longer looking for an ear of grain. You're no longer looking for an ear of corn or corn in the ear. You're simply following a set of dates on the year of a particular month, or on the first month, the 14th day of the month, which have absolutely no meaning whatsoever. The moment you remove Aviv and go by Nisan, you've just changed everything. And most people look at the 14th of Nisan as Passover. When you do that and you begin to calculate, you can calculate the 14th of Nisan 20 years from now. Because you don't have to look for anything. All you have is a calendar that is generated through some printer, some publisher, put it in your hand, and 14 years from now, you can know when the 14th day of Nisan is. But 14 years from now, you can't know when the 14th day of the Aviv, because it requires looking for a particular harvest. In the NIV Compact Dictionary of the Bible, the word Aviv is an ear of corn. In the Holman's Bible, it is an ears of grain. So you got ears of grain in one Bible dictionary, and in another Bible dictionary, you got ears of corn, and pretty much whatever dictionary you use is going to have ears of corn or ears of grain, and some won't even have any of this because they're not even on this particular subject. They may not even have Aviv or Abib in it. They'll have Nisan. It's after the exile that it is called Nisan. And so the biblical references to the month Abib is found in Exodus 13:4. This day came you out in the month Abib. Exodus 23:15, thou shalt keep the feast of unleavened bread. Thou shalt eat unleavened bread 7 days, as I commanded thee in the time appointed of the month Abib. For in it thou camest out from Egypt, and none shall appear before me empty. Exodus 34:18, the feast of unleavened bread shalt thou keep. 7 days thou shalt eat unleavened bread, as I commanded thee in the time of the month Abib. For in the month Abib you came out of Egypt. Every time this word is used, it's in association with two things. When you came out of the land and the Feast of Unleavened Bread. Deuteronomy 16:1, and here's where it gets interesting. Because now, observe the month of Abib, and keep the Passover unto the Jehovah thy Elohim, for in the month of Abib, the Lord thy God brought thee forth out of Egypt by night. Now, what's really interesting is this particular word, observe, because it's the same word that we get keep as it relates to keep the Sabbath, holy. Now, the interesting thing about this is the word suggests that we as a people are supposed to guard, keep, observe. And here's the words, shamar, or shamar, as some would say, to hedge about, to guard, generally to protect, to keep, to mark. By not keeping the Abib, the month of Abib, you are missing the mark. Look narrowly, observe, preserve, reserve, save, wait for, watch. All of these words are in association with the month of Abib. And you know what? Most of us don't guard, don't observe the month. We focus on a day in the month. Now, what's interesting about this is that the Almighty is saying, you need to know when the Aviv is, and you need to guard it, and you need to keep it, and don't let anybody talk you out of it. Because what is he saying? This is the new year for you. That's what he's saying. How many of us have celebrated the biblical new year? Instead, many people are celebrating Jewish New Year's and American New Year's, claiming to be people of the book. With all these instructions concerning the month of Abib, why is the new year Rosh Hashanah? One is kept in Judaism in the seventh month, and by Christians at the end of the 10th month. Now you say, wait a minute, not the 10th month, it's the 12th month. Really? It is the 12th month now, but it is not always the 12th month. Let me show you a little later. Rosh Hashanah is kept by those in Judaism in the 7th month. And here's why. At least this is what is alluded to. Three times thou shalt keep a feast unto me in the year. Thou shalt keep the feast of unleavened bread. Thou shalt eat unleavened bread 7 days as I commanded thee in the time appointed of the month of Abib. For in it thou camest out from Egypt, and none shall appear before me empty. Verse 16. Now notice what it says here. Thou shalt keep the feast of unleavened bread in the time further down appointed of the month of Abib, which is the first year. Verse 16, Exodus 23. And the feast of harvest, the first fruits of thy labor, which thou hast sown in the field, and the feast of ingathering, which is in the end of the year. Now notice here that the feast of ingathering. Now, a couple of things. One thing you see here, and two, something you don't see here. You don't see tabernacle. What you see is ingathering. Now, this is important because in Exodus, it says that in the feast of harvest, the first fruits of thy labor. Well, let's go back. Three times thou shalt keep a feast unto me in the year. Three times. What are the three feasts that we keep? Passover, Pentecost, Tabernacle. Those are the three, right? But here, when the Almighty is given these instructions, he's associating each of these feasts with a particular harvest. Three times thou shalt keep a feast unto me in the year. Thou shalt keep the feast of unleavened bread. Thou shalt eat unleavened bread 7 days as I commanded thee in the time of the appointed month Abib. Abib is a harvest. It relates to a harvest because of the corn in the ear or the grain in the ear. It is harvest time. For in it thou came out from Egypt, and none shall appear before me empty. The next one, the feast of harvest. We know the feast of harvest as the Yiddish Shavuot. It's not Shavuot. Shavuot is a word that is used, but Jehovah announces it as the feast of harvest. People say Pentecost. Well, let me tell you something, ladies and gentlemen. Here's the first Pentecost. Not what happened in Acts chapter 2. Acts chapter 2 is the Greek word that is associated to the feast of harvest. And by changing its name, people can say, yeah, I celebrate Pentecost, but you can't find Pentecost in the Hebrew. So therefore, Pentecost doesn't exist in the Hebrew. So Christians will say, on the first Pentecost. No, it's not the first Pentecost. Here's the first Pentecost, if you look at it from that rationale. Okay? He says, and the feast of ingathering. So there's the three. The month of Aviv, Passover, feast of harvest, Pentecost, ingathering, tabernacle. But he says, which is in the end of the year. So now what happens here is individuals say, okay, well, if the end of the year is tabernacle, and the tabernacle is in the seventh month, then it only makes sense that the new year, if this is the end of the year, and we know we don't have a seventh month year, if this is the end of the year, then it's also the beginning of a new year, which actually begins a new cycle, or it is at the end of the harvest season. The next harvest season is the month Abib. So some brilliant people, quote, came together and decided that, you know what? If the seventh month is the end of the year, then we'll celebrate the end of the year as the beginning of the year or the new year. Now, what's interesting is that in Judaism, the new year is celebrated the first of the month, not the end of the month. So if Judaism was truly going to hold itself to any semblance of truth, its new year would begin in the eighth month at the end of the seventh month, the eighth month, not at the beginning of the seventh month, which is not the end of the month. It is the beginning of the month. I hope I'm not getting too heady for people in here. Because you got folks who want to celebrate Rosh Hashanah on the first of the seventh month, like it's the new year. Who came up with that? Islam is a lot more closer to Judaism than Christianity. Yeah. Islam don't eat swine. And guess when its Sabbath is? Friday evening at sundown. And guess what? It comes, they claim their identity from Abraham. So now you hear on the History Channel, the three major religions that came out of the land of Israel is Judaism, Islam, and Christianity. Christianity did not come out of the land of Israel. Christianity went into the land of Israel. Didn't come from Israel. Messianic, the Hebrew roots came out of Israel, not Christ. Christ was never in Israel. Americans took him there. Well, let me say, Westerners took him there. the Greeks, the Greek Orthodox, the Romans, and all of those individuals. Ouch. Yeah, I know it hurts. Hurt me too. Because all this time, you know, it's like, wow, I want to go to the Holy Land because the roots of Christianity came from there. Messiah was never called Christ. Yeshua was never called Jesus. It's a name Westerners gave him. Not, he's not Hebrew. It's not Hebrew. It's Latin, Greek, and English. Rosh Hashanah, personal name meaning head. And then Rosh Hashanah actually literally mean head of the year. So people are right when they say it's the Jewish New Year. It's just not Jehovah's New Year. You say, well, what's the difference? I'm glad you asked. Because Jewish do a whole lot of stuff Jehovah told them not to do. Do you hear me? A whole bunch of stuff that he said, don't do. And in the past, when they did that, guess what? They were cast out of the land. And people want to argue, well, you know, I'm not here to argue. If you want fact, then the truth, sometimes it hurts. But, you know, folks are enamored. And anytime you say anything that is against Judaism, people think you're attacking Jews when, hey, I know how to make the distinction between Jews and Judaism. Are you with me, ladies and gentlemen? So let's get that straight. Because I know I get some emails today, oh, you have a problem with the Jews. No, I don't. I might be Jewish. Amen. So, no, how can you say that you black and you're not Ethiopian? Yeah, right. I'm telling you, folks got all these ideas in their head, and we just challenge them. So Rosh Hashanah means head of the year. So why is Rosh Hashanah in the seventh month when the seventh month is not the first month? There's a good example of what Judaism does. Judaism changes Jehovah's commands, and then you got Messianic Judaism that follows Judaism, which is not following the commands of Jehovah. They have changed the commands of Jehovah. And anyone who adds to or takes away from the commands of Jehovah, their portion will be removed from the book of life. So those of you who are following Messianic Judaism and doing what the rabbis teach you to do, just know that you might be in for a rude awakening. Those who celebrate Rosh Hashanah in the seventh month as the new year is not following Jehovah, they're following Judaism. That's a fact, Jack. Rosh Hashanah occurs on the first and second days of Tishrei. Now, this comes from Jewish facts, and you can find it on jewishfacts.org. All you got to do is just click it in, jewfacts.org, straight from Judaism. I didn't make this stuff up. This is what they have on their website. Those who celebrate Rosh Hashanah in the seventh month as the new year, it says Rosh Hashanah occurs on the first and second days of Tishrei. In Hebrew, Rosh Hashanah means literally head of the year. No, it doesn't. It does in Israeli Hebrew, which, ladies and gentlemen, is a difference from rabbinic Hebrew, which is a difference from biblical Hebrew. There's a whole bunch of Hebrews out there. And so folks who want to learn Hebrew, you better know what Hebrew you're learning. Because just as you can get the Bible translated in Swahili, you can get the Bible translated in Israeli Hebrew, just like you get it translated in English. So, in Hebrew, Rosh Hashanah means literally head of the year or first of the year. Rosh Hashanah is commonly known as the Jewish New Year. This name is somewhat deceptive. Now, I didn't write this. They say, yeah, this is deceptive. Because there is little similarity between Rosh Hashanah, one of the holiest days of the year, and the American. So now what do they picture this information? It's not saying it's deceptive as it because of the Jews and the Americans and their New Year. What they should have said, it's deceptive because of the Jews and how they celebrate it in the Bible. But what they're saying is that this whole New Year idea came from you Americans. One of the holiest days of the year, and the American midnight drinking bash and daytime football game. Now, this is how Jew facts see American New Year. There is, however, one important similarity between the Jewish New Year and the American one. Many Americans use the New Year as a time to plan a better life, making resolutions. Likewise, the Jewish New Year is a time to begin introspection, looking back at the mistakes of the past year and planning the changes to make in the new year. More on this concept at Days of Awe, which is a link. And I hear people who are Bible people speaking Jewish terms that I know they got from Judaism, as if Judaism is biblical. I even had somebody say, well, you know, the religion of the Bible is Judaism. That's a lie. Judaism is not the religion of the Bible. Judaism is the religion of the Jews. Now, you can turn east and pray all you want. The Bible specifically addresses that issue. Go to my website, Facing East to Pray. The name Rosh Hashanah is not used in the Bible to discuss the holiday. The Bible refers to the holy day as Yom HaZikaron. Now, this is what Jew facts says. The day of remembrance or Yom Teruah. Now, that's what it says in the Bible. Yom Teruah or day of trumpet. The day of the sounding of the shofar. The holiday is instituted in Leviticus 23, 24, and 25. And if you look at that, you'll see that it has absolutely nothing to do with Rosh Hashanah. It's Yom Teruah. So celebrating Rosh Hashanah in the seventh month is following Judaism, not the Bible. The word in Leviticus 23, verse 25 is the word teruah, means to clamor or joy or battle cry, especially clangor of trumpets as an alarm, blowing of the trumpets. Joy, jubilee, loud noise, rejoicing, shouting, high, joyful sounding. So those of you who don't have a shofar to blow, shout. Hallelujah. 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 Shout unto Jehovah with the voice of triumph. That's the stuff they taught us in the church. Don't have a clue as to what it's about, but hey, we're going to do it. The new year in the first month of the Gregorian calendar. So let's talk about some Christian New Years, which is Christians celebrate New Year at the end of the 10th month. Now, I say this because of what you're about to see. October is from Old English and Anglo-French, Old English, and from Latin, October means eighth. It is the eighth month of the early Roman calendar. First use was in the 12th century. December, or December, as it is pronounced, is also from the Latin, and it's the 10th month. So what you're going to find here, ladies and gentlemen, is there's been a whole lot of tinkering. Whole lot of tinkering. And why is there a whole lot of tinkering with the calendars? To get people where they are today on a calendar system that has absolutely nothing to do with Genesis 1 and 2. Or Exodus 12, or Leviticus 23, or this Deuteronomy 16 or any of the other feasts in the Bible, because as Christians, they don't care. And I'm ashamed to say I used to didn't care either. Lost is a jackrabbit. Well, let me find another saying. Forget all that, those cliches. But lost, you know what I'm saying, without a compass, up a creek, without a paddle, and a boat with a hole in it. So December comes from the Latin word for 10th. And for a long period in history, it was referred to as the 10th month of the year, but now it's considered to be the 12th month of the year. January is the first month of the ancient Roman year, not the Hebrew year. So when Israel was in Egypt, there was an Egyptian calendar. Jehovah brought them out of Egypt, gave them their calendar, and now the world is on a Roman calendar. Gregorian calendar, which is a modification of the Julian calendar, which is a modification of a Romulus calendar. Now, I know there's some Romulus in Star Trek. I'm not talking about those Romulus. I'm talking about the founder of Rome. Julius Caesar in 46 BC moved the beginning of the year to January, which literally means is from the word Janus, which is the two-headed Roman god, one looking back and one looking forward. That's what it really is. And this was already established. And so now he's stuck with a calendar with 12 months, and instead of December, as some would say, being the 10th month, added some years to move December up to a 12-month position so that January would be the first month. And if you do your history, you're going to see that there was a whole lot of issues and things going on, and many in the Eastern Orthodox and the Western Orthodox, because you'll find that in the Eastern Orthodox, their year don't begin in January 1st. You'll find that there are religions on the planet today whose new year, and you got the Chinese New Year, you got all kinds of New Years out there that are competing, or in their perspective countries that are now competing with the biblical New Year. And guess who led the charge on the biblical New Year as people know it today? Judaism. So now you got messianics and people coming out of Christendom wanting to become like the Jewish people, celebrating Rosh Hashanah in the seventh month. It's illogical, as Spock would say. When Yeshua was born, and this is where Roman influence, Rome was already the major player when Yeshua came on the scene. When he was born, Caesar was emperor, or Caesar was referred to as emperor. It was in this period, the phrase, render unto Caesar that which is Caesar's, and unto God that which is God, came. And we find that in 22:17, Matthew, tell us therefore, what thinkest thou? Is it lawful to give tribute unto Caesar or not? He's being challenged, really being tried. Folks are trying to trap him, to pit him against the government. You see, notice something, ladies and gentlemen, our Messiah never addressed the government. He always addressed the religious leaders. The only time he addressed the government is when he was brought before the government by the religious leaders, because it's the religious leaders that want to tie your allegiance to the government. So now you got religious Democrats, and you got religious Republicans, And then you got believers who are fighting against each other in politics. How can you vote for that Republican? How can you vote for that Democrat? You should be standing what the Bible say. And the Republicans are praying to the same God as the Democrats are praying to. And they're looking at you all and say, you know what? We got you. Yeah. That's what's being shoved down our throat or those people's throat in the name of religion. Better get off the boat of religion, because the religion is already shipwrecked. It's got blind conductors leading blind passengers. But Yeshua perceived their wickedness and said, why tip ye me, you hypocrites? Show me the tribute money. And they brought unto him a penny. And he said unto them, whose name is this image and subscription? And I would dare say, look at some of your money and see who it belongs to. If Washington's head and Franklin's head and all these other Jefferson's heads on your money and Grant, then guess what? That which you call yours belongs to them, and they're dead. But this is the play. They said unto him, Caesar's. Then said he unto them, then give Caesar what is Caesar, and give Jehovah what is his. This is simple. There's no confusion here. Those who celebrate January 1st as a new year are following that which was established by Caesar, not that which is established by Jehovah. So those who are following Rosh Hashanah is following that which was established by Judaism and the rabbis. And those who are following January 1st are following that which was established by Caesar. So the question is which one do we follow?
This morning, and thank y'all for my life. So glad to
Israel's agriculture calendar began in the fall and dominated the nation's civil calendar. Both calendars, civil and religious, supposedly existed. Notice supposedly. Because you're going to find, when you start researching some of this, you're going to find that they're going to use words that lead you into a conclusion. And you have to be able to read between the lines. Otherwise, you'll be led into a belief system that already supports a belief system. And then you got people who just like you got denominations who write their Bibles and put their commentaries and use their words and take out words they don't like and put words in there that they do like. Because you got people, how come you use God? How come you say Jesus? Probably because I'm not reading from your Bible. Now, you know, we are intelligent people. We know how to research for ourselves. But it's amazing how a person could go from there's just something about that name to how can you say that name? It's like, you know what? You are schizophrenic. That's what you are. I'm not trying to be, but hey, here's what Wikipedia has to say. Oops, sorry about that leak. The celebration of the New Year is the oldest of all holidays. It was first observed in ancient Babylon about 4,000 years ago in the years around 2000 BC. The Babylonian New Year began with the first new moon, actually the first visible crescent after the vernal equinox, first day of spring. The beginning of spring is a logical time to start a new year. After all, it is the season of rebirth, of planting new crops, and of blossoming. January 1st, on the other hand, has no astronomical nor agricultural significance. It is purely arbitrary. It means absolutely nothing. You say, well, wait a minute, it's named after a god. Idols are nothing. Idols are absolutely nothing. You got people say, well, you shouldn't mention the names of an idol. Jehovah says you should not do that in my presence. You don't worship idols. Idols are absolutely nothing. You got individuals who want to call Jehovah an idol. They want to make a golden calf and worship him as if it is Jehovah. Listen, an idol is absolutely nothing. Shouldn't be afraid of them. Shouldn't be afraid of voodoo. You shouldn't be afraid of superstition. So what, the black cat crossed your path? So what, the mirror broke? So what, you walked underneath a ladder? So what, some child opened up the umbrella in the house? So what? But you got people who are so superstitiously religious. How can you be superstitiously religious? Just like you could be religious in any other religion. You could be a devout religious, superstitious person. The Babylonian New Year celebration lasted for 11 days. Each day had its own particular mode of celebration, but it is safe to say that modern New Year's Eve festivities pale in comparison. Now, the stuff they did in Babylon compared to what's going to happen in New York, I'm going to tell you something. You talk about debauchery, idolatry, immorality. You're going to have everybody, many people, not everybody, because I won't be there, and I won't be watching the ball drop. I mean, just imagine this ball coming down this pole. Where did that concept come from? Symbolizing immorality, idolatry, sexual I'm telling you, it's, and what are people going to be doing? They're going to be kissing all in the streets. They're going to be doing all kinds of debaucherous stuff right out in the streets, and the police is going to turn their head. And let's just let them do whatever they want to do. You're going to find listen. That's the sickness of the society we live in, ladies and gentlemen. And all of that surrounds what we call New Year. You got the Christians, you got the Messianics, you got the Jews, you got pretty much every person in America almost celebrating this debaucherous celebration and rejecting that which Jehovah says to observe, to guard, to keep, to mark. What's wrong with us? The Romans continued to observe the new year in late March, but their calendar was continually tampered with by various emperors so that the calendar soon became out of synchronization with the sun. In order to set the calendar right, the Roman Senate in 153 BC declared January 1st to be the beginning of the new year, but tampering continued until Julius Caesar in 46 BC established what has become known as the Julian calendar and then modified by Pope Gregory, which is where we get the Gregorian calendar we have today. The World Book Encyclopedia of 1984, volume 14, page 237 states, the Roman ruler Julius Caesar established January 1st as New Year's Day in 46 BC. The Romans dedicated this day to Janus, the god of gates, doors, and beginnings. The month of January was named after Janus, who had two faces, one looking forward, the other looking backward. This suggests that New Year's celebrations are founded on pagan Roman traditions. Most countries in Western Europe officially adopted January 1st as New Year's Day somewhat before they adopted the Gregorian calendar. In England, the Feast of the Annunciation on March 25th was the first day of the new year until the adoption of the Gregorian calendar in 1752. The March 25th date was known as Annunciation style. The January 1st date was known as circumcision style, because this was the date of the Feast of the Circumcision, being the eighth day counting from December 25th when Christ was supposedly believed to be born. Well, now they had associated the circumcision of Yeshua to this paganism, the church, which came over here into America and brought all of that tradition with them. And you got people who are sitting up in these churches, don't have a clue where this stuff is coming from, celebrating it as if it's holy. Everybody knows that Christ Messiah was not born on December 25th. So how could he be circumcised on January 1st? Another lie. This day was Christian as the beginning of the new year by Pope Gregory as he designed the liturgical calendar. Israel is one country that uses the Gregorian calendar but does not formally celebrate the New Year's holiday, mainly due to objections by religious parties on the holiday's non-Jewish origins. However, there are Israeli Jews who partake in some sort of celebration. The date of the Jewish New Year is celebrated on Rosh Hashanah, no matter where the location. The date of the Islamic New Year moves from year to year because the Islamic calendar is lunar. Therefore, what should be the response of followers of the true Messiah to the festivities of the pagan New Year celebrations? Here's what Daniel says, and I'll close with this. The prophet Daniel received the interpretation of a dream he had in Daniel 7, chapter 1 through 28, or chapter 7, verse 1 through 28, and shared that interpretation under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, that these times would come upon us, and that we know that Daniel was dreaming about the man of lawlessness, the Antichrist, the Anti-Messiah. Daniel revealed the following statement about the Anti-Messiah in verse 25 when he said, "And he shall speak great words against the Most High and shall wear off the saints of the Most High." This is exactly what has happened, because saints have gotten lazy. They don't want to watch the stars. They don't want to establish when the new moon. Give me a calendar. You tell me when it is. Every year, supposedly believers want me to tell them, when is the new year? When is the new year? When is Passover? You got a Bible. I know, you know, this is why Yeshua said he wouldn't give himself to men, because he knew what's in them. I know you. I love you, but I know you. Yeshua knows you. Jehovah knows you. He know we can be some stiff-necked, hard-hearted, rebellious people. The biggest problems Jehovah had with the world was with his own people that he saved. And they ain't changed that much. We haven't changed. Now, I'm working on me. I really am. Every single day. Because I know I'm still a mess. Ask my wife. She'll tell you. But she probably won't tell you how I'm a mess. Right, honey? Right. Good. By following Jehovah's reckoning of time, we do not fall prey to Judaism or Christianity's reckoning of time, and we'll be better prepared for the return of Messiah. Now, I did say I was going to close, but here's actually the closing scripture. I repent. And this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come. When you therefore shall see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel, the prophets. See, Daniel exposed the anti-Messiah and his tactics. The average believer today don't know the reckoning of time. Don't know. Won't even invest in a calendar that will help them to discern the time. At least come close to it. Aren't interested in looking to see when the new moons are. And you know, every month there's a new moon. And the reason why every month there's a new moon, so we can count first moon, second moon, third moon, fourth moon, fifth moon, because you got to understand, you can't celebrate Passover until you identify when the month starts. The month has to have a first day in order for you to celebrate the 14th day at evening. You don't know when the 15th day is if you don't know when the first day began. You can't celebrate the 10th day of the 7th month if you don't know when the first day of the 7th month began. And how do we know when the first day of the 7th month began? By the moon. You see. So we have to follow Jehovah's reckoning of time in order to be at the right place when his time is appointed. The appointed times are the times that he has appointed to meet with us. We don't want to be late. Don't want to be left behind. When you therefore shall see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet stand in the holy place, whosoever read it, let him understand. Then let them which be in Judea flee into the mountains. Let him which is on the housetop not come down to take anything out of his house. You know, like you find people, there's a raging. The only thing that should cause a person to go back in a house that's burning is to save a life. Not to save your piggy bank or any other piece of material thing, because you can lose your life in the process. It's one thing to sacrifice your life for another life. Don't sacrifice your life for stuff, folks. Neither let him which is in the field return back to take his clothes. And warn to them that are with child and to them that give suck in those days. But pray ye that your flight be not in the winter, neither on the Sabbath day. For then shall be great tribulation such as was not since the beginning of the world to this time, no, nor ever shall be. And except those days be shortened. And this is the verse that troubles me. It does, it troubles me. Which is why it is so important that we really begin to get people into truth. Not traditions, not religion, not denominationalism. We have to know the times that we live in. You have to know the time. And you can't be dependent on somebody to tell you what time it is. You have to know for yourself. Except those days be shortened, there should no flesh be saved. But for the elect's sake, those days shall be shortened. Father, we thank you for this time, for this message. I pray it's timely. Help us to be mindful of your time. Help us to be in tune with your reckoning. Help us to see and to know the signs. Help us to be prepared Help us to look, to be aware, and to expect. Help us to be a people of the book, a people of truth, a people who walk in truth, a people who live by truth and not afraid of truth, but will embrace truth and walk in the freedom that truth has been designed to bring. We bless you, pray your blessings upon your people. Yivarekaka Yehovah Baishmereka. Yeah, Yehovah Panavileka Vikuneka. Yisa Yehovah Panavileka Vyasim Laka Shalom. Yehovah bless you and keep you. Yehovah cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. Yehovah lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.
In humble adoration, we bow before your throne. As we come before your presence, we honor you alone. So we lift up our voices as trumpets heralding you. You are the King of glory, so this is what we do. In humble adoration, Father, we bow before your throne. As we come before your presence, we honor you alone. So we lift up our voices as trumpets heralding you. You are the King of glory, so this is what we do. We worship you today. We worship you today. We worship you today. We worship you today. Oh, we worship you today. We worship you today. We worship you today. We worship you today. Father, how we love you today. And we worship you just because of who you are. Oh, I wish I had somebody to help me sing in humble adoration.
In humble adoration, we bow before your throne. As we come before your presence,
Father, we honor you.
We honor you alone.
So we lift up
our voices.
As trumpets
hurling you.
You are
the King of glory.
So this is what
so
we do.
This is what we do.
In humble adoration. Father, we bow before your throne. As we
come before your presence.
So we lift up our voices. As trumpets heralding you.
You are the King of glory.
Yes. So this is what we do.
This is what we do.
We worship you today.
We worship you today.
Jesus,
we worship you today.
Just for who you are today.
We worship you today.
experience. Second Samuel continued. Joab, son of Zeruiah, knew that the king's heart longed for Absalom. So Joab sent someone to Tekoa and had a wise woman brought from there. He said to her,
"Pretend you are in mourning. Dress in mourning clothes and don't use any cosmetic lotions. Act like a woman who has spent many days grieving for the dead. Then go to the king and speak these words to him."
And Joab put the words in her mouth. When the woman from Tekoa went to the king, she fell with her face to the ground to pay him honor. And she said,
"Help me, your majesty."
The king asked her,
"What is troubling you?"
She said,
"I am a widow. My husband is dead. I, your servant, had two sons. They got into a fight with each other in the field, and no one was there to separate them. One struck the other and killed him. Now, the whole clan has risen up against your servant. They say, 'Hand over the one who struck his brother down so that we may put him to death for the life of his brother whom he killed. Then we will get rid of the heir as well.' They would put out the only burning coal I have left, leaving my husband neither name nor descendant on the face of the earth."
The king said to the woman,
"Go home, and I will issue an order in your behalf."
But the woman from Tekoa said to him,
"Let my lord the king pardon me and my family, and let the king and his throne be without guilt."
The king replied,
"If anyone says anything to you, bring them to me, and they will not bother you again."
She said,
"Then let the king invoke the Lord his God to prevent the avenger of blood from adding to the destruction, so that my son will not be destroyed."
"As surely as the Lord lives,"
he said,
"not one hair of your son's head will fall to the ground."
Then the woman said,
"Let your servant speak a word to my lord the king."
"Speak,"
he replied. The woman said,
"Why then have you devised a thing like this against the people of God? When the king says this, does he not convict himself? For the king has not brought back his banished son. Like water spilt on the ground, which cannot be recovered, so we must die. But that is not what God desires. Rather, he devises ways so that a banished person does not remain banished from him. And now I have come to say this to my lord the king, because the people have made me afraid. Your servant thought, 'I will speak to the king. Perhaps he will grant his servant's requests. Perhaps the king will agree to deliver his servant from the hand of the man who is trying to cut off both me and my son from God's inheritance.' And now your servant says, 'May the word of my lord the king secure my inheritance. For my lord the king is like an angel of God in discerning good and evil. May the Lord your God be with you.'"
Then the king said to the woman,
"Don't keep from me the answer to what I am going to ask you."
"Let my lord the king speak,"
the woman said. The king asked,
"Isn't the hand of Joab with you in all this?"
The woman answered,
"As surely as you live, my lord the king, no one can turn to the right or to the left from anything my lord the king says. Yes, it was your servant Joab who instructed me to do this, and who put all these words into the mouth of your servant. Your servant Joab did this to change the present situation. My lord has wisdom like that of an angel of God. He knows everything that happens in the land."
The king said to Joab,
"Very well. I will do it. Go bring back the young man Absalom."
Joab fell with his face to the ground to pay him honor, and he blessed the king. Joab said,
"Today your servant knows that he has found favor in your eyes, my lord the king, because the king has granted his servant's request."
Then Joab went to Jeshur and brought Absalom back to Jerusalem. But the king said,
"He must go to his own house. He must not see my face."
So Absalom went to his own house and did not see the face of the king. In all Israel there was not a man so highly praised for his handsome appearance as Absalom. From the top of his head to the sole of his foot, there was no blemish in him. Whenever he cut the hair of his head, he used to cut his hair once a year because it became too heavy for him. He would weigh it, and its weight was 200 shekels by the royal standard. 3 sons and a daughter were born to Absalom. His daughter's name was Tamar, and she became a beautiful woman. Absalom lived 2 years in Jerusalem without seeing the king's face. Then Absalom sent for Joab in order to send him to the king, but Joab refused to come to him. So he sent a second time, but he refused to come. Then he said to his servants,
"Look, Joab's field is next to mine, and he has barley there. Go and set it on fire."
So Absalom's servants set the field on fire. Then Joab did go to Absalom's house, and he said to him,
"Why have your servants set my field on fire?"
Absalom said to Joab,
"Look, I sent word to you and said, 'Come here so I can send you to the king to ask, why have I come from Geshur? It would be better for me if I was still there.' Now then, I want to see the king's face. And if I am guilty of anything, let him put me to death."
So Joab went to the king and told him this. Then the king summoned Absalom, and he came in and bowed down with his face to the ground before the king. And the king kissed Absalom. In the course of time, Absalom provided himself with a chariot and horses and with 50 men to run ahead of him. He would get up early and stand by the side of the road leading to the city gate. Whenever anyone came with a complaint to be placed before the king for a decision, Absalom would call out to him,
"What town are you from?"
He would answer,
"Your servant is from one of the tribes of Israel."
Then Absalom would say to him,
"Look, your claims are valid and proper, but there is no representative of the king to hear you."
And Absalom would add,
"If only I were appointed judge in the land, then everyone who has a complaint or case could come to me, and I would see that they receive justice."
Also, whenever anyone approached him to bow down before him, Absalom would reach out his hand, take hold of him, and kiss him. Absalom behaved in this way toward all the Israelites who came to the king asking for justice, and so he stole the hearts of the people of Israel. At the end of 4 years, Absalom said to the king,
"Let me go to Hebron and fulfill a vow I made to the Lord. While your servant was living at Geshur in Aram, I made this vow. If the Lord takes me back to Jerusalem, I will worship the Lord in Hebron."
The king said to him,
"Go in peace."
So he went to Hebron. Then Absalom sent secret messengers throughout the tribes of Israel to say,
"As soon as you hear the sound of the trumpets, then say, 'Absalom is king in Hebron.'"
200 men from Jerusalem had accompanied Absalom. They had been invited as guests and went quite innocently, knowing nothing about the matter. While Absalom was offering sacrifices, he also sent for Ahithophel the Gilonite, David's counselor, to come from Gilo, his hometown. And so the conspiracy gained strength, and Absalom's following kept on increasing. A messenger came and told David,
"The hearts of the people of Israel are with Absalom."
Then David said to all his officials who were with him in Jerusalem,
"Come, we must flee, or none of us will escape from Absalom. We must leave immediately, or he will move quickly to overtake us and bring ruin on us and put the city to the sword."
The king's officials answered him,
"Your servants are ready to do whatever our lord the king chooses."
The king set out, with his entire household following him. But he left 10 concubines to take care of the palace. So the king set out, with all the people following him, and they halted at the edge of the city. All his men marched past him, along with all the Kerethites and Pelethites, and all the 600 Gittites who had accompanied him from Gath, marched before the king. The king said to Ittai, the Gittite,
"Why should you come along with us? Go back and stay with King Absalom. You are a foreigner, an exile from your homeland. You came only yesterday, and today shall I make you wander about with us when I do not know where I am going? Go back and take your people with you. May the Lord show you kindness and faithfulness."
But Ittai replied to the king,
"As surely as the Lord lives, and as my lord the king lives, wherever my lord the king may be, whether it means life or death, there will your servant be."
David said to Ittai,
"Go ahead. March on."
So Ittai the Gittite marched on with all his men and the families that were with him. The whole countryside wept aloud as all the people passed by. The king also crossed the Kidron Valley, and all the people moved on toward the wilderness. Zadok was there too, and all the Levites who were with him were carrying the Ark of the Covenant of God. They set down the Ark of God, and Abiathar offered sacrifices until all the people had finished leaving the city. Then the king said to Zadok,
"Take the Ark of God back into the city. If I find favor in the Lord's eyes, he will bring me back and let me see it in his dwelling place again. But if he says, 'I am not pleased with you,' then I am ready. Let him do to me whatever seems good to him."
The king also said to Zadok the priest,
"Do you understand? Go back to the city with my blessing. Take your son Ahimaaz with you, and also Abiathar's son Jonathan. You and Abiathar return with your two sons. I will wait at the fords in the wilderness until word comes from you to inform me."
So Zadok and Abiathar took the Ark of God back to Jerusalem and stayed there. But David continued up the Mount of Olives, weeping as he went. His head was covered and he was barefoot. All the people with him covered their heads too and were weeping as they went up. Now David had been told,
"Ahithophel is among the conspirators with Absalom."
So David prayed,
"Lord, turn Ahithophel's counsel into foolishness."
When David arrived at the summit where people used to worship God, Hushai the Archite was there to meet him, his robe torn and dust on his head. David said to him,
"If you go with me, you will be a burden to me. But if you return to the city and say to Absalom, 'Your Majesty, I will be your servant. I was your father's servant in the past, but now I will be your servant,' then you can help me by frustrating Ahithophel's advice. Won't the priests Zadok and Abiathar be there with you? Tell them anything you hear in the king's palace. Their two sons, Ahimaaz, son of Zadok, and Jonathan, son of Abiathar, are there with them. Send them to me with anything you hear."
So Hushai, David's confidant, arrived at Jerusalem as Absalom was entering the city. When David had gone a short distance beyond the summit, there was Ziba, the steward of Mephibosheth, waiting to meet him. He had a string of donkeys saddled and loaded with 200 loaves of bread, 100 cakes of raisins, 100 cakes of figs, and a skin of wine. The king asked Ziba,
"Why have you brought these?"
Ziba answered,
"The donkeys are for the king's household to ride on. The bread and fruit are for the men to eat, and the wine is to refresh those who become exhausted in the wilderness."
The king then asked,
"Where is your master's grandson?"
Ziba said to him,
"He is staying in Jerusalem because he thinks, 'Today the house of Israel will restore to me my grandfather's kingdom.'"
Then the king said to Ziba,
"All that belonged to Mephibosheth is now yours."
"I humbly bow,"
Ziba said.
"May I find favor in your eyes, my lord the king."
As King David approached Bahurim, a man from the same clan as Saul's family came out from there. His name was Shimei, son of Gera, and he cursed as he came out. He pelted David and all the king's officials with stones, though all the troops and the special guard were on David's right and left. As he cursed, Shimei said,
"Get out! Get out, you murderer! You scoundrel! The Lord has repaid you for all the blood you shed in the household of Saul, in whose place you have reigned. The Lord has given the kingdom into the hands of your son, Absalom. You have come to ruin because you are a murderer."
Then Abishai, son of Zeruiah, said to the king,
"Why should this dead dog curse my lord, the king? Let me go over and cut off his head."
But the king said,
"What does this have to do with you, you sons of Zeruiah? If he is cursing because the Lord said to him, 'Curse David,' who can ask, 'Why do you do this?'"
David then said to Abishai and all his officials,
"My son, who is of my own flesh, is trying to take my life. How much more than this Benjamite? Leave him alone. Let him curse, for the Lord has told him to. It may be that the Lord will look upon my misery and restore to me his covenant blessing instead of his curse today."
So David and his men continued along the road, while Shimei was going along the hillside opposite him, cursing as he went and throwing stones at him and showering him with dirt. The king and all the people with him arrived at their destination exhausted, and there he refreshed himself. Meanwhile, Absalom and all the men of Israel came to Jerusalem, and Ahithophel was with him. Then Hushai the Archite, David's confidant, went to Absalom and said to him,
"Long live the king! Long live the king!"
Absalom said to Hushai,
"So this is the love you show your friend? If he's your friend, why didn't you go with him?"
Hushai said to Absalom,
"No, the one chosen by the Lord, by these people and by all the men of Israel, his I will be, and I will remain with him. Furthermore, whom should I serve? Should I not serve the son? Just as I served your father, so I will serve you."
Absalom said to Ahithophel,
"Give us your advice. What should we do?"
Ahithophel answered,
"Sleep with your father's concubines, whom he left to take care of the palace. Then all Israel will hear that you have made yourself obnoxious to your father, and the hands of everyone with you will be more resolute."
So they pitched a tent for Absalom on the roof, and he slept with his father's concubines in the sight of all Israel. Now in those days, the advice Ahithophel gave was like that of one who inquires of God. That was how both David and Absalom regarded all of Ahithophel's advice. Ahithophel said to Absalom,
"I would choose 12,000 men and set out tonight in pursuit of David. I would attack him while he is weary and weak. I would strike him with terror, and then all the people with him will flee. I would strike down only the king and bring all the people back to you. The death of the man you seek will mean the return of all. All the people will be unharmed."
This plan seemed good to Absalom and to all the elders of Israel. But Absalom said,
"Summon also Hushai the Archite, so we can hear what he has to say as well."
When Hushai came to him, Absalom said,
Ahithophel has given this advice. Should we do what he says? If not, give us your opinion.
Hushai replied to Absalom,
The advice Ahithophel has given is not good this time. You know your father and his men. They are fighters, and as fierce as a wild bear robbed of her cubs. Besides, your father is an experienced fighter. He will not spend the night with the troops. Even now, he is hidden in a cave or some other place. If he should attack your troops first, whoever hears about it will say there has been a slaughter among the troops who follow Absalom. Then even the bravest soldier, whose heart is like the heart of a lion, will melt with fear. For all Israel knows that your father is a fighter and that those with him are brave. So I advise you, let all Israel from Dan to Beersheba, as numerous as the sand on the seashore, be gathered to you, with you yourself leading them into battle. Then we will attack him wherever he may be found, and we will fall on him as dew settles on the ground. Neither he nor any of his men will be left alive. If he withdraws into a city, then all Israel will bring ropes to that city, and we will drag it down to the valley until not so much as a pebble is left.
Absalom and all the men of Israel said,
The advice of Hushai the Archite is better than that of Ahithophel.
For the Lord had determined to frustrate the good advice of Ahithophel in order to bring disaster on Absalom. Hushai told Zadok and Abiathar, the priests,
Ahithophel has advised Absalom and the elders of Israel to do such and such, but I have advised them to do so and so. Now send a message at once and tell David, do not spend the night at the fords in the wilderness. Cross over without fail, or the king and all the people with him will be swallowed up.
Jonathan and Ahimeaz were staying at Enrogel. A female servant was to go and inform them, and they were to go and tell King David, for they could not risk being seen entering the city. But a young man saw them and told Absalom. So the two of them left at once and went to the house of a man in Bahurim. He had a well in his courtyard, and they climbed down into it. His wife took a covering and spread it out over the opening of the well, and scattered grain over it. No one knew anything about it. When Absalom's men came to the woman at the house, they asked,
Where are Ahimeaz and Jonathan?
The woman answered them,
They crossed over the brook.
The men searched, but found no one, so they returned to Jerusalem. After they had gone, the two climbed out of the well and went to inform King David. They said to him,
Set out and cross the river at once. Ahithophel has advised such and such against you.
So David and all the people with him set out and crossed the Jordan. By daybreak, no one was left who had not crossed the Jordan. When Ahithophel saw that his advice had not been followed, he saddled his donkey and set out for his house in his hometown. He put his house in order and then hanged himself. So he died and was buried in his father's tomb. David went to Mahanaim, and Absalom crossed the Jordan with all the men of Israel. Absalom had appointed Amasa over the army in place of Joab. Amasa was the son of Jether, an Ishmaelite who had married Abigail, the daughter of Nahash, and sister of Zariah, the mother of Joab. The Israelites and Absalom camped in the land of Gilead. When David came to Mahanaim, Shobai, son of Nahash from Rabbah of the Ammonites, and Machir, son of Ammiel from Lodeber, and Barzillai, the Gileadite from Rogalim, brought bedding and bowls and articles of pottery. They also brought wheat and barley, flour and roasted grain, beans and lentils, honey and curds, sheep and cheese from cow's milk for David and his people to eat. For they said,
The people have become exhausted and hungry and thirsty in the wilderness.
David mustered the men who were with him and appointed over them commanders of thousands and commanders of hundreds. David sent out his troops, a third under the command of Joab, a third under Joab's brother Abishai, son of Zeruiah, and a third under Ittai the Gittite. The king told the troops,
I myself will surely march out with you.
But the men said,
"You must not go out. If we are forced to flee, they won't care about us. Even if half of us die, they won't care. But you are worth 10,000 of us. It would be better now for you to give us support from the city."
The king answered,
"I will do whatever seems best to you."
So the king stood beside the gate while all his men marched out in units of hundreds and of thousands. The king commanded Joab, Abishai, and Ittai,
"Be gentle with the young man Absalom, for my sake."
And all the troops heard the king giving orders concerning Absalom to each of the commanders. David's army marched out of the city to fight Israel, and the battle took place in the forest of Ephraim. There, Israel's troops were routed by David's men, and the casualties that day were great, 20,000 men. The battle spread out over the whole countryside, and the forest swallowed up more men that day than the sword. Now Absalom happened to meet David's men. He was riding his mule, and as the mule went under the thick branches of a large oak, Absalom's hair got caught in the tree. He was left hanging in midair, while the mule he was riding kept on going. When one of the men saw what had happened, he told Joab,
"I just saw Absalom hanging in an oak tree."
Joab said to the man who had told him this,
"What? You saw him? Why didn't you strike him to the ground right there? Then I would have had to give you 10 shekels of silver and a warrior's belt."
But the man replied,
"Even if 1,000 shekels were weighed out into my hands, I would not lay a hand on the king's son. In our hearing, the king commanded you and Abishai and Ittai protect the young man Absalom for my sake. And if I had put my life in jeopardy, and nothing is hidden from the king, you would have kept your distance from me."
Joab said,
"I'm not going to wait like this for you."
So he took 3 javelins in his hand and plunged them into Absalom's heart while Absalom was still alive in the oak tree. And 10 of Joab's armor bearers surrounded Absalom, struck him, and killed him. Then Joab sounded the trumpet, and the troops stopped pursuing Israel, for Joab halted them. They took Absalom, threw him into a big pit in the forest, and piled up a large heap of rocks over him. Meanwhile, all the Israelites fled to their homes. During his lifetime, Absalom had taken a pillar and erected it in the king's valley as a monument to himself. For he thought,
"I have no son to carry on the memory of my name."
He named the pillar after himself, and it is called Absalom's Monument to this day. Now Ahimaaz, son of Zadok, said,
"Let me run and take the news to the king that the Lord has vindicated him by delivering him from the hand of his enemies."
"You are not the one to take the news today,"
Joab told him.
"You may take the news another time, but you must not do so today, because the king's son is dead."
Then Joab said to a Cushite,
"Go, tell the king what you have seen."
The Cushite bowed down before Joab and ran off. Ahimaaz, son of Zadok, again said to Joab,
"Come what may, please let me run behind the Cushite."
But Joab replied,
"My son, why do you want to go? You don't have any news that will bring you a reward."
He said,
"Come what may, I want to run."
So Joab said,
"Run."
Then Ahimaaz ran by way of the plain and outran the Cushite. While David was sitting between the inner and outer gates, the watchman went up to the roof of the gateway by the wall. As he looked out, he saw a man running alone. The watchman called out to the king and reported it. The king said,
"If he is alone, he must have good news."
And the runner came closer and closer. Then the watchman saw another runner, and he called down to the gatekeeper,
"Look, another man running alone."
The king said,
"He must be bringing good news too."
The watchman said,
"It seems to me that the first one runs like Ahimaaz, son of Zadok."
"He's a good man,"
the king said.
"He comes with good news."
Then Ahimaaz called out to the king,
"All is well."
He bowed down before the king with his face to the ground and said,
Praise be to the Lord your God. He has delivered up those who lifted their hands against my lord the king.
The king asked,
Is the young man Absalom safe?
Ahimeaz answered,
I saw great confusion, just as Joab was about to send the king's servant and me, your servant, but I don't know what it was.
The king said,
Stand aside and wait here.
So he stepped aside and stood there. Then the Cushite arrived and said,
My lord the king,
hear the good news. The Lord has vindicated you today by delivering you from the hand of all who rose up against you.
The king asked the Cushite,
Is the young man Absalom safe?
The Cushite replied,
May the enemies of my lord the king and all who rise up to harm you be like that young man.
The king was shaken. He went up to the room over the gateway and wept. As he went, he said,
Oh, my son, Absalom. Oh, my son, Absalom. Oh, if only I had died instead of you. Oh, Absalom, my son. No!
Joab was told,
The king is weeping and mourning for Absalom.
And for the whole army, the victory that day was turned into mourning, because on that day the troops heard it said,
The king is grieving for his son.
The men stole into the city that day, as men steal in who are ashamed when they flee from battle. The king covered his face and cried aloud,
Oh, my son! Oh, Absalom! Oh, Absalom! My son!
Then Joab went into the house to the king and said,
Today you have humiliated all your men who have just saved your life and the lives of your sons and daughters and the lives of your wives and concubines. You love those who hate you and hate those who love you. You have made it clear today that the commanders and their men mean nothing to you. I see that you would be pleased if Absalom were alive today and all of us were dead. Now go out and encourage your men. I swear by the Lord that if you don't go out, not a man will be left with you by nightfall. This will be worse for you than all the calamities that have come on you from your youth till now.
So the king got up and took his seat in the gateway. When the men were told,
The king is sitting in the gateway.
They all came before him. Meanwhile, the Israelites had fled to their homes. Throughout the tribes of Israel, all the people were arguing among themselves, saying,
The king delivered us from the hand of our enemies. He is the one who rescued us from the hand of the Philistines.
But now he has fled the country to escape from Absalom. And Absalom, whom we anointed to rule over us, has died in battle. So why do you say nothing about bringing the king back?
King David sent this message to Zadok and Abiathar, the priests.
Ask the elders of Judah, why should you be the last to bring the king back to his palace, since what is being said throughout Israel has reached the king at his quarters? You are my relatives. My own flesh and blood. So why should you be the last to bring back the king? And say to Amasa, Are you not my own flesh and blood? May God deal with me, be it ever so severely, if you are not the commander of my army for life in place of Joab.
He won over the hearts of the men of Judah, so that they were all of one accord. They sent word to the king,
Return. You and all your men.
Then the king returned and went as far as the Jordan. Now the men of Judah had come to Gilgal to go out and meet the king and bring him across the Jordan. Shimei, son of Gera, the Benjamite from Bahurim, hurried down with the men of Judah to meet King David. With him were 1,000 Benjamites, along with Ziba, the steward of Saul's household, and his 15 sons and 20 servants. They rushed to the Jordan where the king was. They crossed at the ford to take the king's household over and to do whatever he wished. When Shimei, son of Gera, crossed the Jordan, he fell prostrate before the king and said to him,
May my lord not hold me guilty. Do not remember how your servant did wrong on the day my lord the king left Jerusalem. May the king put it out of his mind. For I, your servant, know that I have sinned. But today I have come here as the first of the whole house of Joseph, to come down and meet my lord the king.
Then Abishai, son of Zeruiah, said,
Shouldn't Shimei be put to death for this? He cursed the Lord's anointed.
David replied,
What does this have to do with you, you sons of Zeruiah? What right do you have to interfere? Should anyone be put to death in Israel today? Don't I know that today I am king over Israel?
So the king said to Shimei,
You shall not die.
And the king promised him on oath. Mephibosheth, Saul's grandson, also went down to meet the king. He had not taken care of his feet, or trimmed his mustache, or washed his clothes from the day the king left until the day he returned safely. When he came from Jerusalem to meet the king asked him,
Why didn't you go with me, Mephibosheth?
He said,
My lord the king, since I, your servant, am lame, I said, I will have my donkey saddled and will ride on it so I can go with the king. But Ziba, my servant, betrayed me, and he has slandered your servant to my lord the king. My lord the king is like an angel of God, so do whatever you wish. All my grandfather's descendants deserve nothing but death from my lord the king. But you gave your servant a place among those who eat at your table. So what right do I have to make any more appeals to the king?
The king said to him,
Why say more? I order you and Ziba to divide the land.
Mephibosheth said to the king,
Let him take everything, now that my lord the king has returned home safely.
Barzillai the Gileadite also came down from Rogalim to cross the Jordan with the king and to send him on his way from there. Now Barzillai was very old, 80 years of age. He had provided for the king during his stay in Mahanaim, for he was a very wealthy man. The king said to Barzillai,
Cross over with me and stay with me in Jerusalem, and I will provide for you.
But Barzillai answered the king,
How many more years will I live that I should go up to Jerusalem with the king? I am now 80 years old. Can I tell the difference between what is enjoyable and what is not? Can your servant taste what he eats and drinks? Can I still hear the voices of male and female singers? Why should your servant be an added burden to my lord the king? Your servant will cross over the Jordan with the king for a short distance. But why should the king reward me in this way? Let your servant return, that I may die in my own town, near the tomb of my father and mother. But here is your servant, Kimham. Let him cross over with my lord, the king. Do for him whatever you wish.
The king said,
Kimham shall cross over with me, and I will do for him whatever you wish, and anything you desire from me, I will do for you.
So all the people crossed the Jordan, and then the king crossed over. The king kissed Barzillai and bid him farewell, and Barzillai returned to his home. When the king crossed over to Gilgal, Kimham crossed with him. All the troops of Judah and half the troops of Israel had taken the king over. Soon all the men of Israel were coming to the king and saying to him,
Why did our brothers, the men of Judah, steal the king away and bring him and his household across the Jordan, together with all his men?
All the men of Judah answered the men of Israel,
We did this because the king is closely related to us. Why are you angry about it? Have we eaten any of the king's provisions? Have we taken anything for ourselves?
Then the men of Israel answered the men of Judah,
We have 10 shares in the king, so we have a greater claim on David than you have. Why then do you treat us with contempt?
Weren't we the first to speak of bringing back our king?
But the men of Judah responded even more harshly than the men of Israel. Now a troublemaker named Sheba, son of Bichri, a Benjamite, happened to be there. He sounded the trumpet and shouted,
"We have no share in David, no part in Jesse's son. Everyone to your tents, Israel!"
So all the men of Israel deserted David to follow Sheba, son of Bichri. But the men of Judah stayed by their king all the way from the Jordan to Jerusalem. When David returned to his palace in Jerusalem, he took the 10 concubines he had left to take care of the palace and put them in a house under guard. He provided for them, but had no sexual relations with them. They were kept in confinement till the day of their death, living as widows. Then the king said to Amasa,
"Summon the men of Judah to come to me within 3 days, and be here yourself."
But when Amasa went to summon Judah, he took longer than the time the king had set for him. David said to Abishai,
"Now Sheba, son of Bichri, will do us more harm than Absalom did. Take your master's men and pursue him, or he will find fortified cities and escape from us."
So Joab's men and the Carathites and Pelethites and all the mighty warriors went out under the command of Abishai. They marched out from Jerusalem to pursue Sheba, son of Bichri. While they were at the great rock in Gibeon, Amasa came to meet them. Joab was wearing his military tunic, and strapped over it at his waist was a belt with a dagger in its sheath. As he stepped forward, it dropped out of its sheath. Joab said to Amasa,
"How are you, my brother?"
Then Joab took Amasa by the beard with his right hand to kiss him. Amasa was not on his guard against the dagger in Joab's hand, and Joab plunged it into his belly, and his intestines spilled out on the ground. Without being stabbed again, Amasa died. Then Joab and his brother Abishai pursued Sheba, son of Bichri. One of Joab's men stood beside Amasa and said,
"Whoever favors Joab, and whoever is for David, let him follow Joab."
Amasa lay wallowing in his blood in the middle of the road, and the man saw that all the troops came to a halt there. When he realized that everyone who came up to Amasa stopped, he dragged him from the road into a field and threw a garment over him. After Amasa had been removed from the road, everyone went on with Joab to pursue Sheba, son of Bichri. Sheba passed through all the tribes of Israel, to Abel Beth-Maacah, and through the entire region of the Bichrites, who gathered together and followed him. All the troops with Joab came and besieged Sheba in Abel Beth-Maacah. They built a siege ramp up to the city, and it stood against the outer fortifications. While they were battering the wall to bring it down, a wise woman called from the city.
Ooh! Ooh, listen! Listen! Tell Joab to come here so I can speak to him!
He went toward her, and she asked,
"Are you Joab?"
"I am,"
he answered. She said,
"Listen to what your servant has to say."
"I'm listening,"
he said. She continued,
"Long ago they used to say, get your answer at Abel, and that settled it. We are the peaceful and faithful in Israel. You are trying to destroy a city that is a mother in Israel. Why do you want to swallow up the Lord's inheritance?"
"Far be it from me,"
Joab replied.
"Far be it from me to swallow up or destroy. That is not the case. A man named Sheba, son of Bichri, from the hill country of Ephraim, has lifted up his hand against the king, against David. Hand over this one man, and I'll withdraw from the city."
The woman said to Joab,
"His head will be thrown to you from the wall."
Then the woman went to all the people with her wise advice, and they cut off the head of Sheba, son of Bichri, and threw it to Joab. So he sounded the trumpet, and his men dispersed from the city, each returning to his home. And Joab went back to the king in Jerusalem. Joab was over Israel's entire army. Benaiah, son of Jehoiada, was over the Kerethites and Pelethites. Adoniram was in charge of forced labor. Jehoshaphat, son of Ahilud, was recorder. Sheva was secretary. Zadok and Abiathar were priests. And Ira the Jairite was David's priest. During the reign of David, there was a famine for 3 successive years. So David sought the face of the Lord. The Lord said,
"It is on account of Saul and his blood-stained house. It is because he put the Gibeonites to death."
The king summoned the Gibeonites and spoke to them. Now the Gibeonites were not a part of Israel, but were survivors of the Amorites. The Israelites had sworn to spare them, but Saul in his zeal for Israel and Judah had tried to annihilate them. David asked the Gibeonites,
"What shall I do for you? How shall I make atonement so that you will bless the Lord's inheritance?"
The Gibeonites answered him,
"We have no right to demand silver or gold from Saul or his family, nor do we have the right to put anyone in Israel to death."
"What do you want me to do for you?"
David asked. They answered the king,
"As for the man who destroyed us and plotted against us so that we have been decimated and have no place anywhere in Israel, let 7 of his male descendants be given to us to be killed and their bodies exposed before the Lord at Gibeah of Saul, the Lord's chosen one."
So the king said,
"I will give them to you."
The king spared Mephibosheth, son of Jonathan, the son of Saul, because of the oath before the Lord between David and Jonathan, son of Saul. But the king took Armoni and Mephibosheth, the 2 sons of Ai's daughter Rizpah, whom she had borne to Saul, together with the 5 sons of Saul's daughter Merab, whom she had borne to Adriel, son of Barzillai, the Meholathite. He handed them over to the Gibeonites, who killed them and exposed their bodies on a hill before the Lord. All 7 of them fell together. They were put to death during the first days of the harvest, just as the barley harvest was beginning. Rizpah, daughter of Aya, took sackcloth and spread it out for herself on a rock, from the beginning of the harvest till the rain poured down from the heavens on the bodies. She did not let the birds touch them by day, or the wild animals by night. When David was told what Aya's daughter Rizpah, Saul's concubine, had done, he went and took the bones of Saul and his son Jonathan from the citizens of Jabesh-Gilead. They had stolen their bodies from the public square at Beth-Shan, where the Philistines had hung them after they struck Saul down on Gilboa. David brought the bones of Saul and his son Jonathan from there, and the bones of those who had been killed and exposed were gathered up. They buried the bones of Saul and his son Jonathan in the tomb of Saul's father, Kish, at Zelah in Benjamin, and did everything the king commanded. After that, God answered prayer in behalf of the land. Once again, there was a battle between the Philistines and Israel. David went down with his men to fight against the Philistines, and he became exhausted. And Ishbibenob, one of the descendants of Rapha, whose bronze spearhead weighed 300 shekels and who was armed with a new sword, said he would kill David. But Abishai, son of Zeruiah, came to David's rescue. He struck the Philistine down and killed him. Then David's men swore to him, saying,
"Never again will you go out with us to battle, so that the lamp of Israel will not be extinguished."
In the course of time, there was another battle with the Philistines at Gob. At that time, Sibukai the Hushathite killed Sam, one of the descendants of Rapha. In another battle with the Philistines at Gob, Elhanan, son of Jair the Bethlehemite, killed the brother of Goliath the Gittite, who had a spear with a shaft like a weaver's rod. In still another battle, which took place at Gath, there was a huge man with 6 fingers on each hand and 6 toes on each foot, 24 in all. He also was descended from Rapha. When he taunted Israel, Jonathan, son of Shimeah, David's brother, killed him. These 4 were descendants of Rapha in Gath, and they fell at the hands of David and his men. David sang to the Lord the words of this song when the Lord delivered him from the hand of all his enemies and from the hand of Saul. He said,
"The Lord is my rock, my fortress, and my deliverer. My God is my rock, in whom I take refuge, my shield and the horn of my salvation. He is my stronghold, my refuge, and my savior. From violent people you saved me. I called to the Lord, who is worthy of praise, and have been saved from my enemies. The waves of death swirled about me. The torrents of destruction overwhelmed me. The cords of the grave coiled around me. The snares of death confronted me. In my distress, I called to the Lord. I called out to my God. From his temple, he heard my voice. My cry came to his ears. The earth trembled and quaked. The foundations of the heavens shook. They trembled because he was angry. Smoke rose from his nostrils. Consuming fire came from his mouth. Burning coals blazed out of it. He parted the heavens and came down. Dark clouds were under his feet. He mounted the cherubim and flew. He soared on the wings of the wind. He made darkness his canopy around him, the dark rain clouds of the sky. Out of the brightness of his presence, bolts of lightning blazed forth. The Lord thundered from heaven. The voice of the Most High resounded. He shot his arrows and scattered the enemy. With great bolts of lightning, he routed them. The valleys of the sea were exposed, and the foundations of the earth laid bare at the rebuke of the Lord, at the blast of breath from his nostrils. He reached down from on high and took hold of me. He drew me out of deep waters. He rescued me from my powerful enemy, from my foes who were too strong for me. They confronted me in the day of my disaster, but the Lord was my support. He brought me out into a spacious place. He rescued me because he delighted in me. The Lord has dealt with me according to my righteousness. According to the cleanness of my hands, he has rewarded me. For I have kept the ways of the Lord. I am not guilty of turning from my God. All his laws are before me. I have not turned away from his decrees. I have been blameless before him and have kept myself from sin. The Lord has rewarded me according to my righteousness, according to my cleanness in his sight. To the faithful, you show yourself faithful. To the blameless, you show yourself blameless. To the pure, you show yourself pure. But to the devious, you show yourself shrewd. You save the humble, but your eyes are on the haughty to bring them low. You, Lord, are my lamp. The Lord turns my darkness into light. With your help, I can advance against the troop. With my God, I can scale a wall. As for God, his way is perfect. The Lord's word is flawless. He shields all who take refuge in him. For who is God besides the Lord? And who is the rock except our God? It is God who arms me with strength and keeps my way secure. He makes my feet like the feet of a deer and causes me to stand on the heights. He trains my hands for battle. My arms can bend a bow of bronze. You make your saving help my shield. Your help has made me great. You provide a broad path for my feet so that my ankles do not give way. I pursued my enemies and crushed them. I did not turn back till they were destroyed. I crushed them completely, and they could not rise. They fell beneath my feet. You awed me with strength for battle. You humbled my adversaries before me. You made my enemies turn their backs in flight, and I destroyed my foes. They cried for help, but there was no one to save them. To the Lord, but he did not answer.
I beat them as fine as the dust of the earth. I pounded and trampled them like mud in the streets. You have delivered me from the attacks of the peoples. You have preserved me as the head of nations. People I did not know now serve me. Foreigners cower before me. As soon as they hear of me, they obey me. They all lose heart. They come trembling from their strongholds. The Lord lives. Praise be to my rock. Exalted be my God, the rock, my Savior. He is the God who avenges me, who puts the nations under me, who sets me free from my enemies. You exalted me above my foes. From violent people, you rescued me. Therefore, I will praise you, Lord, among the nations. I will sing the praises of your name. He gives his king great victories. He shows unfailing kindness to his anointed, to David and his descendants forever.
These are the last words of David, the inspired utterance of David, son of Jesse, the utterance of the man exalted by the Most High, the man anointed by the God of Jacob, the hero of Israel's songs.
The Spirit of the Lord spoke through me. His word was on my tongue. The God of Israel spoke. The Rock of Israel said to me, when one rules over people in righteousness, when he rules in the fear of God, he is like the light of morning at sunrise on a cloudless morning, like the brightness after rain that brings grass from the earth. If my house were not right with God, surely he would not have made with me an everlasting covenant, arranged and secured in every part. Surely he would not bring to fruition my salvation and grant me my every desire. But evil men are all to be cast aside like thorns, which are not gathered with the hand. Whoever touches thorns uses a tool of iron or the shaft of a spear. They are burned up where they lie.
These are the names of David's mighty warriors. Josheph-Bashibeth, a Tekemonite, was chief of the three. He raised his spear against 800 men whom he killed in one encounter. Next to him was Eleazar, son of Dodai, the Ahohite. As one of the three mighty warriors, he was with David when they taunted the Philistines gathered at Pass Damim for battle. Then the Israelites retreated, but Eleazar stood his ground and struck down the Philistines till his hand grew tired and froze to the sword. The Lord brought about a great victory that day. The troops returned to Eleazar, but only to strip the dead. Next to him was Shammah, son of Agee, the Hararite. When the Philistines banded together at a place where there was a field full of lentils, Israel's troops fled from them. But Shammah took his stand in the middle of the field. He defended it and struck the Philistines down, and the Lord brought about a great victory. During harvest time, three of the 30 chief warriors came down to David at the cave of Adullam, while a band of Philistines was encamped in the valley of Rephaim. At that time, David was in the stronghold, and the Philistine garrison was at Bethlehem. David longed for water and said,
"Oh, that someone would give me a drink of water from the well near the gate of Bethlehem."
So the three mighty warriors broke through the Philistine lines, drew water from the well near the gate of Bethlehem, and carried it back to David. But he refused to drink it. Instead, he poured it out before the Lord.
"Far be it from me, Lord, to do this,"
he said.
"Is it not the blood of men who went at the risk of their lives?"
And David would not drink it. Such were the exploits of the three mighty warriors. Abishai, the brother of Joab, son of Zeruiah, was chief of the three.
he raised his spear against 300 men whom he killed, and so he became as famous as the three. Was he not held in greater honor than the three? He became their commander, even though he was not included among them. Benaiah, son of Jehoiada, a valiant fighter from Kabzeel, performed great exploits. He struck down Moab's two mightiest warriors. He also went down into a pit on a snowy day and killed a lion. And he struck down a huge Egyptian. Although the Egyptian had a spear in his hand, Benaiah went against him with a club. He snatched the spear from the Egyptian's hand and killed him with his own spear. Such were the exploits of Benaiah, son of Jehoiada. He too was as famous as the three mighty warriors. He was held in greater honor than any of the 30, but he was not included among the three, and David put him in charge of his bodyguard. Among the 30 were Asahel, the brother of Joab, Elhanan, son of Dodo from Bethlehem, Shammah the Haradite, Elikah the Haradite, Helas the Paltite, Ira, son of Ikish from Tekoa, Abiezer from Anathoth, Sibukai the Hushathite, Salmon the Ahohite, Meharai the Netophathite, Helad, son of Beunah the Netophathite, Ithai, son of Ribai from Gibeah in Benjamin, Benaiah the Parathonite, Hidai from the ravines of Gaish, Abialban the Arbathite, Asmaveth the Barhumite, Eliaba the Sheobanite, the sons of Jashon, Jonathan son of Shammah the Hararite, Ahiam son of Sharah the Hararite, Eliphelet son of Ahazbi the Meukathite, Eliam son of Ahithophel the Gilonite, Hezro the Carmelite, Peori the Arbite, Igal son of Nathan from Zobah, the son of Haggai, Zelek the Ammonite, Nahari the Beurathite, the armor-bearer of Joab, son of Zeruiah, Ira the Ithrite, Garab the Ithrite, and Uriah the Hittite. There were 37 in all. Again the anger of the Lord burned against Israel, and he incited David against them, saying,
Go and take a census of Israel and Judah.
So the king said to Joab and the army commanders with him,
Go throughout the tribes of Israel from Dan to Beersheba and enroll the fighting men so that I may know how many there are.
But Joab replied to the king,
May the Lord your God multiply the troops 100 times over, and may the eyes of my lord the king see it. But why does my lord the king want to do such a thing?
The king's word, however, overruled Joab and the army commanders. So they left the presence of the king to enroll the fighting men of Israel. After crossing the Jordan, they camped near Aroer, south of the town in the gorge, and then went through Gad and on to Jazer. They went to Gilead and the region of Tatim-Hodshai and on to Dan-Jaan and around toward Sidon. Then they went toward the fortress of Tyre and all the towns of the Hivites and Canaanites. Finally, they went on to Beersheba in the Negev of Judah. After they had gone through the entire land, they came back to Jerusalem at the end of 9 months and 20 days. Joab reported the number of the fighting men to the king. In Israel, there were 800,000 able-bodied men who could handle a sword, and in Judah, 500,000. David was conscience-stricken after he had counted the fighting men, and he said to the Lord,
I have sinned greatly. What I have done. Now, Lord, I beg you, take away the guilt of your servant. I have done a very foolish thing.
Before David got up the next morning, the word of the Lord had come to Gad, the prophet, David's seer.
Go and tell David, this is what the Lord says. I am giving you 3 options. Choose one of them for me to carry out against you.
So Gad went to David and said to him,
Shall there come on you 3 years of famine in your land? Or 3 months of fleeing from your enemies while they pursue you? Or 3 days of plague in your land? Now then, think it over and decide how I should answer the one who sent me.
David said to Gad,
I am in deep distress. Let us fall into the hands of the Lord, for his mercy is great. But do not let me fall into human hands.
So the Lord sent a plague on Israel from that morning until the end of the time designated. And 70,000 of the people from Dan to Beersheba died. When the angel stretched out his hand to destroy Jerusalem, the Lord relented concerning the disaster and said to the angel who was afflicting the people,
Enough! Withdraw your hand.
The angel of the Lord was then at the threshing floor of Araunah, the Jebusite. When David saw the angel who was striking down the people, he said to the Lord,
I have sinned. I, the shepherd, have done wrong. These are but sheep. What have they done? Let your hand fall on me and my family.
On that day, Gad went to David and said to him,
Go up and build an altar to the Lord on the threshing floor of Araunah the Jebusite.
So David went up, as the Lord had commanded, through Gad. When Araunah looked and saw the king and his officials coming toward him, he went out and bowed down before the king with his face to the ground. Araunah said,
Why has my lord the king come to his servant?
To buy your threshing floor,
David answered.
So I can build an altar to the Lord, that the plague on the people may be stopped.
Araunah said to David,
Let my lord the king take whatever he wishes and offer it up. Here are oxen for the burnt offering, and here are threshing sledges and ox yokes for the wood. Your majesty, Araunah gives all this to the king.
Araunah also said to him,
May the Lord your God accept you.
But the king replied to Araunah,
No. I insist on paying you for it.
Inspired by The Bible Experience.
Thank you for joining us today, and we'll see you again next time.